The first part is talking about gunshot residue, but I'd like to continue our discussion on bomb evidence, because there is some physical evidence left behind. So this is a Tannerite explosion. I don't know if you know about Tannerite. It's a two-part explosive that can be purchased at Academy. You can buy this stuff. Let me pause it for a second. Okay. And what it's supposed to be is for a long distance shot indicator. So what you're supposed to do with this is you mix up some Tannerite with the catalyst and it makes it gray. So you have this little gray powder and the white Tannerite beads, and you mix it together, and the gray gets sticky and sticks to the white powder. And so now you have a substance that can detonate. And then you put it in a little plastic sack, and you staple it to the target board, and then you put your target with the bullseye right over that little packet, okay? And so then when you're shooting at 500 yards, you can't really see if you've hit the bullseye until you hit it. And when you hit it, then you see this pop, you see this indicator, yeah. And so if you miss, you keep shooting and you see through the scope, you shoot and you didn't see a puff or anything like that, but if you hit the bullseye, you see pow, okay? And so it's a shot indicator. That's what it was created to do. Well, people buy it now and mix up the whole bin, okay, and then shoot the whole package, and then it detonates, okay? And so here's a Tannerite on top of a watermelon, okay, out here. This is from a former student of mine. I don't know if y'all know Robert Stanton, okay?
Hey, why is he former?
Yeah, so they're shooting it with a high-powered rifle. Now, the nice thing about this stuff is it's insensitive. If you drop the container, it doesn't go off. You actually have to hit it with a high-velocity round. So even a .22 has a hard time setting it off. So you have to hit it with something going faster with more weight than a .22 slug.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's actually surprising.
Let me back up.
Where's the watermelon?
It's like beautiful property.
Yeah, exactly. So they did a watermelon, they did a couple of other things. Let's see. That's the most dramatic because of the watermelon. But then they did a cell phone.
Oh no.
So they set it on top of a cell phone. And look how much was left over. And so leave it in the package, because with lithium batteries and so on, there may be some metal contaminants that I don't want you to get on your hands and then you wipe your eye. But this is the remains of that cell phone. Okay? And this was only a quarter pound of Tannerite, and it did that to a cell phone.
Is that a Nokia?
Yeah, I don't know what kind of phone it is, but you could certainly tell. If you look at it, you can see all the markings are still there. My point is not the destruction of the cell phone, but the lack of destruction of the cell phone.
I don't even know
when this was. You saw the blast that it took out that watermelon, and there was just bits of watermelon everywhere, but there were still lots of bits of watermelon. Right? You could see lots of evidence left behind, and that's what this portion of the course is, the physical pieces left behind that are going to be related to that crime. What can you find off of them? I think he took the battery out of this because it's missing, but if he had not, then that's the best place to get fingerprints, because who hasn't had their phone go wonky, unless you have an iPhone, and had, you know, if you've got an Android, you take the battery out, okay, to completely shut the phone down, you know, and then you put the battery back in. Well, how do you take the battery out and put the battery back in without getting your thumbprint on it? Right? And then you put that all back together, and then you forget about it, and then you commit a crime with it, and you try to destroy it or what have you, and then they take the pieces apart, and there's the battery, and they can dust it for prints and maybe find a print on that battery. So there's an enormous amount of material left behind, even after an explosion like this. So that's really part of today's lesson. And so that, you know, just thinking about this watermelon. You know, this is one of those things that it's a watermelon that the shop was really not contained, but if it was contained, again, that watermelon could be other objects. It could be nails or ball bearings or whatever. And so you might have shrapnel evidence. You might find nails everywhere. Well, if it's a construction site, that's not not unusual, okay? But if it's a sidewalk outside of the Boston Marathon, it's very unusual, and you're going to find nails in people's legs, you're going to find all this stuff. Was that used as part of the bomb blast? You know, you'd have to figure out if it was. And then, maybe, how you get nails and ball bearings stuck to an object, what would you typically use?
Adhesives?
What, glue, maybe? But what's even easier than glue?
Tape.
Okay. Tape.
Like tape?
What kind of tape are you probably going to use?
Duct tape.
Yeah, exactly. Duct tape has an enormously thick adhesive layer. That's what makes it so good. And you pull that duct tape off and you go, rip, fingerprint right there. And they can pull fingerprints off the adhesive side of duct tape. Okay, so try to use nitrile gloves with duct tape. That's not going to end well. Okay. Rip, and then you can't get it off your glove. You're going to end up sticking the glove to the object because it'll never come off of that duct tape. Okay. And so smart criminals would probably use scissors. Don't, you know, it's going to be on the
stage.
But, but anyway, again, duct tape is going to be physical evidence. And you can find, perhaps, you can find prints on the adhesive side of duct tape. Even if they stick it down on something and it's still adhered to that surface, you can use Goo Gone, which is essentially hexane. So if you've got hexane, you can run a little fountain of hexane down on the backside of that tape and pull it off. So hexane will release the adhesive from the surface, but it doesn't dissolve the adhesive. If it dissolved the adhesive, that would be bad for evidence. But they found that Goo Gone won't dissolve the adhesive on duct tape, it will just release it from the surface. So the key to adhesion is entanglement. And that's really not on the test, but that's a physical chemistry thing, so I'm always handled it, hit that hard. But the key to adhesion, if you want to get this substance to stick to that substance, is to get the fibers entangled. Well, metal oxide surfaces or things like that, wood, they don't really have fibers to entangle with, but they've got roughness. And so if you've got an oxidized surface and it's rough because you have a porous oxide, if you have a polymer adhesive and you want to get it to stick to that surface, you gotta make sure the surface is clean so that the adhesive fibers, the polymer fibers, can get entangled in the surface. And so that's what's going on with adhesion. If you use that hexane, it helps you untangle those fibers and pull it off. And then you let the hexane evaporate, and then you've got the adhesive side of the duct tape exposed. And then you can put a filler in there and get the fingerprints. So that's the cell phone destroyed by the tannerite. So let's now focus on gunshot residue. First, we need to look at when we have to talk about guns and evidence from shooting, most of it is related to the cartridge. You got the slug and the primer and the casing. You've got a bunch of different kinds. And so that's the slug. You know what kind of slug this is. Of course, this is a cross section, so it's been cut in half. But what if you saw that kind of slug, how would you characterize it?
Isn't that
whole
thing a shotgun?
No, this is like a, I don't know what caliber, but it looks like a 38 special or something. It's a little bit long. Yeah. But this slug here, if you were to characterize this slug, you would call this a hollow point.
Oh.
You see how the point is hollow? Why do they do that? And so when it hits the object, it opens up. Because again, bullets are meant to kill something. You know, animals or people, right?
So it's explode.
And so it spreads out to create as much damage inside that object as possible. Okay, it's gruesome to think about if it's a person, but not so gruesome if that person's threatening your person, self-defense, right? Or if you want all the energy of that bullet to be deposited in that person and not anybody or anything behind them, when would that be important? When you want all the energy of that projectile to be deposited in the person that you're shooting and none of it to escape that person and go behind them.
When
they're holding a victim? Yeah, that would be you'd have to really trust that bullet to shoot the person. But the victim would be in front. Yeah, so that would be maybe not a situation you'd want. But if you were, behind them and you didn't want it to go through them to hit the victim. But right now, there's a hollow point bullet now with a plastic ball in the front of it. okay, to really create a energy spread. And those were developed for air marshals. Do you know what an air marshal is?
On
a plane. You want all the energy of that projectile to stop in the person that you shoot so that you don't get the passenger behind them. Or the side of the plane.
Yeah.
Right? Start poking holes in the plane. That's not good, right? Put your finger there, miss, and don't let go. So this right here is the gunpowder, which again is not an explosive. Gunpowder is a propellant. And so it actually burns and it creates gas, and that gas propels the projectile. Okay. This is the casing. And then something has to light the gunpowder. And so this is the primer. And so the primer is one, if you can't find the slug, maybe you can find the casing which has the primer in it. And the primer is another critical piece of evidence. Because every gun that fires is hitting that primer with what's called a firing pin. And that firing pin has, you know, a characteristic to it. You know, it might have a little metal burr on it or some kind of shape that's slightly different than the firing pin on any other weapon. And so you can look at those primers through a microscope and see that they're all different. So here are the primers from shotgun shells. My cousin reloads, so he's shot all of these. Okay, so these will get your hands dirty, but I don't think it's going to be anything toxic. So you can keep one of these if you want. No, it's just a primer. So I got this.
Oh, really?
My friend's a chemistry class. Here you go.
Okay.
Yeah, but the point is to look at the back. That's where the firing pin strikes, and you see the little dent. And so you have inside that little can, that little brass can, is lead stiffenate. So it's a shock sensitive compound. It's called a low explosive. It just starts to burn vigorously when it gets shocked by that firing pin. And so firing pin hits it, lead stiffenate starts to decompose and burn. And then on this side is a little rubber gasket that's already been burned out. So these are all used. But on this side is a little rubber gasket to keep the lead stiffenate dry. And when the lead stiffenate burns, it bursts that rubber gasket and the fire goes in to light the gunpowder. Yeah. And it happens very quickly, as you might imagine. You shoot the gun, firing pin, bam, lead stiffenate burns, gasket bursts, gunpowder lights, starts to burn vigorously because it contains its own oxygen, and it pushes the bullet out the muzzle. Okay. So. Now, we could get a microscope and look at all of these primers, and there might be some primers in here. Look at all of these firing pin divots, and we might be able to identify which shotgun my cousin used. Okay, he's got several, right? So we could classify these, and these were his 12-gauge shotgun, these were his 20-gauge shotgun. You know, this was the youth 20-gauge shotgun that he, you know, shoots with his son. And so you could really classify the guns based upon the dent provided by the firing pin. Even though we, especially with a shotgun, you don't have any ballistics. So the barrel is rifled. It's got grooves machined into it to spin the bullet. And so a spinning bullet is going to not want to change directions. Think about your bicycle. The only reason it's easy to balance a bicycle while it's moving is because of the conservation of momentum. So there's angular momentum associated with the wheels. And so you have, if the wheels are going forward, you have an angular momentum vector that's based on the right-hand rule. So the motion is with your fingers, the vector is sticking out the left side of the wheel. You never see it, but it's there. Okay? And it doesn't want to change. Yeah. And so that makes it easy to balance a bicycle. A bullet has the same thing. If it's spinning clockwise, the angular momentum vector is pointing out the front. It doesn't really matter what direction it's pointing, but by physics, it's pointing out the front. And so it's spinning, and it doesn't want to change. And so it's even resistant somewhat to wind. It would be worse to shoot an object that wasn't spinning. And they found that out early on with just muzzle balls, you know, musket balls. These balls would fly through space like a knuckleball in baseball. So it's kind of bouncing around through the wind and everything, and it was very inaccurate. Once you started spinning the projectiles, then it became much more accurate. So So there's different kinds of projectiles. This is a hollow point, but you have jacketed or unjacketed. So this round, see this tiny little bit of copper around the outside? That's a copper jacket. But this hollow point's been drilled out, so there's no copper on the inside. If there is copper all the way around, it's called a full metal jacket. So that's not just a movie. That's actually the bullet. Full metal jacket is the.
That was a good one.
And that's a nice. We use them for target practice. They're pretty cheap. Again, it makes a really nice hole in the target. So you use a full metal jacket for target practice. Now you can have a full, just no jacket. You can just have lead all the way around. But you can have. You can even have some exotic coatings too. You can have nickel-coated bullets that are silver-looking. This HydroShock is what I was talking about with that plastic ball and a hollow point for the plastic ball in the end. So that plastic ball, just again, it's blunt, and so whenever it hits an object, the ball slows down and it causes the bullet to split out. And all that energy goes, instead of in one direction, to the side directions, and creates havoc inside. It's a HydroShock. They test it on kind of like jugs of water, but it's not a plastic surface. It's more related to realistic, elasticity of skin. But they actually put, for the air marshals, they're actually putting research into how do you deliver all of your energy into the first object that you hit. And so that's their trademark, HydroShock. Critical Defense by Hornady also has a similar thing. Now you might have heard of cop killer bullets or things like that where they're coated in Teflon. And some of those bullets are illegal in certain areas. It's a ballistic tip, so it's a pointed tip, and the whole slug is coated in Teflon. And it's a very sharp tip, because what it's trying to do is penetrate the fibers in Kevlar. And so it's meant to go through bulletproof vests. Okay? If that tip can get between the fibers in Kevlar and there's Teflon on the surface that sloughs off, then it might make it through. Okay, so those are illegal in some jurisdictions. It's not gonna get through like a ceramic plate. So some of these bulletproof vests have ceramic plates that basically turn to powder. So that energy is delivered to the ceramic, and the point pressure from a projectile is then divided over the whole surface area of the plate. And so that lowers its pressure on your body quite a bit, and then the rest of that energy is going into busting up that ceramic plate, so it turns to powder. So it's not gonna stop too many bullets after that.
It's not reusable
because it's been powderized, so it's already been used up. So then you would basically pull the flap out, dump out all the powder, put another plate in. But so the vest may be reusable, but not the plates. And then the gunpowder is shown here. We can zoom in on the gunpowder and see that there are different constituents. The major primer elements have lead stiffenate, but lead's impure, and it has barium and antimony in it. And so those three elements are trace elements that we look for in gunshot residue. So the projectile leaves the bullet leaves the gun very quickly, but there's a cloud of smoke behind, and that cloud of smoke contains lead, antimony, and barium. And that gets on your face, on your hands, on your clothing, and so you're looking for gunshot residue. There's other kinds of components that you can use, like FTIR to discover, like nitrocellulose, nitroglycerin, diphenylamine. These are stabilizers. We want our ammunition to be able to have a long shelf life. So you don't want your gunpowder to get stale and then not burn well. And so you put in things that are antioxidants. And these are all antioxidants. So oxygen, if it gets into the gunpowder container, will react with these first, and then with carbon next.
That's a really good question. He's like, why did they, he knows they use them smokeless gunpowder, but back in like the day they used the gunpowder smoke, what did they do to minimize the smoke?
Okay, the smoke, there's two definitions of smoke, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So smoke, like from a fireplace or burning leaves, that's just unburned soot, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And so one way to reduce that is to have it burn faster and better, so more complete. So a more complete burn will reduce the smoke. And so this is also reduces the flash. So dinitrile toluene will burn very vigorously early on, and so that will help reduce the smoke to some degree. But the other concept of smoke, you might hear smokeless propellants, and what they've done is they've taken as much of the chlorine out of the formulation as possible. Mm-hmm. So if you have any kind of oxidizing agent put in your powder to speed up the burn that contains chlorates or perchlorates, then they produce HCl in the gases. So some of the gases can be very caustic to you breathing them in. And so when they have propellants like rocket-propelled grenades, mm-hmm. that propellant had a lot of perchlorate in it, and it produced a lot of HCl. That's not great. If you're in a Humvee and the bad guys are chasing you, you shoot a rocket-propelled grenade out of mm-hmm. the back of a Humvee, then all of that smoke is in the cab of the Humvee, and if it contains HCl, you're going to spend the next, you know, long period of time coughing.
Right.
You're not going to be very effective. And so trying to remove any kind of chlorine source from your propellant would make that propellant a smokeless propellant. Mm-hmm. So that's really two definitions of smoke, right? One is just unburned soot, okay. and the other definition of smoke is HCl gas, or any kind of caustic gas. So adding in more nitrogen components produces hot nitrogen gas, and that's not caustic to your lungs. Okay, heat might be, but not the chemical part of it. So they've been trying to replace as many of the perchlorate salts in these explosive powders, and I mean these propellant powders, with unstable nitrogen compounds like azides or azos, more azides and there's some really crazy nitrogen compounds mm-hmm. That they're using for these smokeless propellants. So here's a friend of mine from high school. She posted this on Facebook, and I said, "Hey, Brandon, can I use your picture in my forensic class to show the gunshot residue?" She's shooting a revolver, okay? Revolvers are so dirty because they have these gaps, you know, where the bullet is in the barrel. And so look at all of that smoke, okay? Now that's traditional smoke. That's unburned carbon. And look where it's landing. It's landing on her hand, it's landing on her wrist, on her watch.
Her watch.
Yes. The wind blows, it's going to get on her face and her clothing. Okay, she's going to have gunshot residue all over her. Now it's going to be mostly concentrated on her hands. Okay, so that's what we're looking for. That's the physical evidence. And so when you come, you know, if you're an investigator, you swab the hand. If you're a forensic analyst, you're going to see, okay, this swab was from the hand. That's going to be the one that has the most concentrated amount of gunshot residue if this person had used the firearm. And so you would swab this area of the hand. And this is a quick picture of the hot propellant gases. Here's the slug. Look at that. So it's coming right out. And notice how it doesn't line up with the barrel. Is that because the picture's fake? No, the barrel has already moved up.
And recoil.
Yeah. It's already moved up a little bit. Now, if you've got a strong grip, the bullet can exit before the barrel moves up. But if you got a wimpy grip, okay, you aim here and you keep shooting high. You know, and so if you ever choose to learn how to shoot a pistol or what have you, focus on holding the gun as tight as possible. But if you constantly shoot high, then you're not holding it tight enough. Okay, you need to hold it as still as possible so that the bullet can actually get out of the barrel before the gun moves. Okay, so this gun's moving a little bit. And what are all of these little bits? Those are the hot bits of gunshot residue. So those are propellant grains that are still burning. They're little hot bits of residue of lead and barium and antimony that are going to fly back and make this cloud, and they're going to end up on your hands and so on. Look how much, this is a revolver, look how much flame is coming out between the revolver and the bullet, I mean, and the barrel. You know? So again, that's where a lot of that smoke is coming from. It's getting all over the finger. So this is the trigger finger. So the use of gunshot residue, if you saw the victim, okay, then they were pretty close, right? And so you can measure from the spread if it was point blank or if it was 3 feet-ish, you know, or further. Yeah.
I'm just curious, like, once you get the bit, how are they doing on your hands, and you go wash your hands, is there still, like, a high concentration of it?
Not a high concentration. So you could wash it off. Yeah. Yeah, you could wash it off. And so that's why it's important to, you know, secure the scene and talk to the people involved, you know, before they have a chance to go and destroy evidence.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Don't think as it gets on their
yeah, but the clothing would be, it would be tricky to get off of like a sweater or something because there's so many fibers
or like
there.
In your watch.
You really are going to be trying to find a needle in a haystack, but the watch, you might be able to get into the grooves.
Or if they're wearing a ring or something, mm-hmm. they take off their ring when they wash their hands.
Yeah,
they're not cleaning
exactly.
their ring.
And so we're also trying to tell whether or not a person has discharged a firearm. You know, if you've got, say, someone is faking someone else's suicide and yeah, they've got gunshot residue on their head, but there's none at all on their hand, then they probably didn't shoot that weapon.
Okay. They were there.
But. Yeah, they were there. But. So here's a point blank shot. You see how the charring is very close, okay, a very small circle. What you could do is you could then, there's several tests that are in the notes where you sort of put some cheesecloth down and you spray some developer and you pull that off and then you put a colorimetric developer on and you can test for gunshot residue. So, you know, maybe this was just a hot metal object and charred the fabric. You know, you say, well, clearly it's a gunshot. Well, not until you test it. Okay, so you've got to test it to make sure. There's a bunch of different presumptive tests, like the grease test and the rhodizonate test. And then there's instrumental analysis. And we'll focus mostly on SEM EDX. So scanning electron microscopy will give you an image of the particles. And then the energy dispersive X-rays will give you the elemental analysis of those particles. X-ray fluorescence is essentially being used here. You're hitting it with electrons, and you're kicking out core electrons, and then when the outer electrons drop down, you're getting essentially a fluorescence-type signal, and you detect the energy of those photons, and you can get the identity of the elements. Now, the organic compounds, you might be able to take that extract and then test that for nitrocellulose or some of the stabilizers like diphenylamine. And you would use the typical gas chromatography method for that, probably. But CE is a new technique called capillary electrophoresis, and it's useful as well. So let me I've just really put these in here just to show you, in general, what kind of tests look like. So this is a paper or cheesecloth. In this case, it's a gelatin-coated photographic paper. So you put that down on the place where you think there's an entrance wound. You put that down and pull the particles off, and then you spray a developer on there, and you're looking for a particular color. The same kind of thing for the sodium rhodizonate test. So this is the grease test, this is the rhodizonate test, and it's pink color. But let's look at the pictures. Here's the swabs of, you know, the swab collection. So you could swab someone's hand, swab their clothing. The nice thing is the swab comes with an evidence container. Isn't that cool? So you open it up, you swab, you close it, tap, and put tape on it with a number, an evidence number, and then you catalog what that is. It came from their hand, and you do another swab on their clothing, okay? And maybe the watch is separate, and so you could have three different pieces of evidence, and they should all confirm that this person was the one that was very close to the vicinity of a discharged firearm. You know, here's another one. This is kind of cool. It's a little spongy thing on the end, and it caps, there's a cap that goes over it, and you can run the tape around the outside to seal it. And so you can come around with this sponge, you open the cap, it's clean and sterile, and you go and you just dab everywhere, and all of that, dab, and so then you test that, and it's kind of tiny, so it's about the size of a penny. And then you put it in the SEM, and this is a scanning electron microscope. So inside here is a vacuum. They have what they call atmospheric or environmental SEMs, where the chamber is still, to get the electrons down on your sample, is still vacuumed. But down here in the sample chamber, it's separated from the vacuum chamber by a tiny little hole. And so the electrons are beaming out of that hole, and very little gas is getting into the electron chamber. So the electron chamber is still at a pretty high vacuum, but your sample doesn't have to be at that high vacuum. And then you can focus on a particle, blast it with electrons, and get X-rays off. And the X-rays travel up here to an X-ray detector. And the X-ray detector is cooled with liquid nitrogen. So this is a liquid nitrogen doer up on top. And so if you're running an SEM and you want to do EDX, you know, you climb on a stool and fill it with liquid nitrogen and get the detector all cooled down and ready to go. So this is the electron optics. They hit the sample. You can detect the electrons. You can have an X-ray detector and so on. This is what's going on. The electron beam knocks out a core electron. Core electrons, I think, are easier to hit. They're closer to the nucleus. They're not dispersed, right? It's a smaller target, so it's easier to hit, you know, smaller target. That sounds odd. Why is it easier to hit a smaller target? Well, because you've got either one electron dispersed or two electrons dispersed over a small 1s orbital, or two electrons dispersed over a 2s orbital, right? And so the interaction with that electron cloud is a smaller interaction because it's spread out over.
There's more density.
Yeah, you can think of it as concentration, right? The 2s electrons are less concentrated than the 1s electrons. It's easier to hit the 1s electrons. And the 1s electrons are closest to the nucleus. And every element has a different number of protons. So the energy of those 1s electrons is characteristic of every element on the periodic table. So you get an X-ray out, you know, and you measure the energy of that X-ray, you know exactly what element you're dealing with. And so this is a scanning electron microscopy X-ray energy plot. And so what you have is, here you've got some oxygen, this is from the sample. Here's lead, molybdenum, here's antimony, here's barium. So if you see lead, antimony, barium, that's gunshot residue. From the primers. And then here are the particles. So these are scanning electron micrographs of the particles. What is, describe these in your words. So I want you to look at these pictures and tell me in your words what you see.
Spherical.
Most of them are kind of spherical, but you got some weird ones like this.
Porous.
Some are porous. This one's not necessarily porous, but some are. What's that?
They're smooth like they've been melted.
Yes, they're smooth like they've been melted. That's probably the number one characteristic, okay? Is that they look like they've been melted. Like it's a particle that's come together hot and cooled, like a little lava drop.
A little plant.
Yeah, so this is the only one that looks a little odd because it's got bumps on the surface, but it must have just collected, you know, molten, collected, and then cooled, and when it cooled, it shrank and left these little bumps. These look like they collected and they were hollow, like maybe there was a little void in the middle that was still burning. And so they migrated to the surface and cooled, and everything that was inside burned out. Okay. And then some of that stuff lands on your hand and it's hot. Okay. It may still be burning a little bit, but it's a tiny little particle. It's not enough to really burn you because it's only a few microjoules left to burn, but it's still a high temperature. So your nerve goes, hey, and then it's over. Okay, so it's not enough to like really penetrate and burn your skin because that would require a large mass.
Hey.
So it's a small mass, but it's still a high temperature. So your nerve tells you, but then it's over.
Those shells behind it.
Yeah, so this is what gunshot residue looks like. This is what pollen looks like, but they're the same size on average.
Freaking pollen.
Yeah, it's everywhere, as my nose can tell you, okay? And so how do you tell between gunshot residue and pollen?
That doesn't look melted.
That is not melted, yeah.
It looks organic.
Little spiky balls.
Little spiky balls so that they stick on things, like plants, you know? Like the little...
Or like little brains.
Yeah. The other thing, too, is just look at the complexity of this thing. This is a natural product. This was constructed meticulously by the little proteins and things and plants that make them. Okay? Gunshot residue is haphazard. It's just a molten particle that cooled down. It wasn't engineered one protein at a time. So the complexity of pollen is way much more advanced than the complexity of any kind of gunshot residue particle. Okay, a gunshot residue particle was created very quickly, hot process, molten particle cools down. Okay, and there's no beautiful structure to it. That's beautiful.
It is.
And my allergy hates it, but it's amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, no wonder I sneeze. Look how pokey that is.
It is.
It's like tickle, tickle. And then this right here, that looks like the sugar smacks, you know, the
Coral. Like the
old
coral.
Cereal.
It's a coral too.
Yeah.
I thought it looked like a little brain.
Like a little
yeah.
coral.
Yeah, exactly. So this is really, and some tiny little particles here.
Yeah.
Which you can't really see on the screen, but on this better monitor, they also have some little structure. But they're smoother than these others, and that might actually fool me if I saw those. But so let's say you got this tiny little particle, you think, well, gee, I think that is gunshot residue. So you aim your electron beam at it, and you turn on your X-ray, and you blast away. And if you don't see that, you don't see at least two out of the three, barium and antimony, or barium and lead, then you can't classify it as gunshot residue. So the micrograph is not enough. If you just look at the picture and you think it's GSR, and you go do an SEM, you know, X-ray analysis of it, and it doesn't come up with those three markers, then it's not going to be gunshot residue. And now it's a real issue for non-traditional weapons. So again, the particles would be confirmed as GSR. You're looking for at least two of the three components, like lead, bismuth, and antimony. And so those are the things that, if they start taking those out of the primers, then forensically we're going to have to adjust what we look for. So just the presence of GSR can't determine whether the victim's death was the result of a homicide or suicide. But you know, you can still use that to kind of characterize the nature of the crime. The absence of a large amount of GSR on their hand, if then a gun was placed in their hand, I think would be something that you could make a case for. But as a forensic analyst, all you're going to do is just say it was not on the hand, you know, or below detection. And then the prosecutor or the defense is gonna make the case with that evidence. So you just analyze the samples that you get and then hand your reports over, kind of like Joe was saying. You just write the reports and turn them in, and then the prosecutor or the defense attorneys do with it what they do.
Yeah.
So a lot of this is just stuff you can read on your own. And so they're trying to get rid of lead because it's toxic, but again, it's such a small amount. It's not like you're going to ingest it.
You do
have false positives and false negatives. I mean, you can, if you think that if you're bad at microscopy and you don't know what pollen looks like, you can say, oh, there's GSR all over this person. You know, and you're just, that's a false positive. Okay, if they wash the hands, then you got a false negative. They actually shot, but then they had a chance to get the stuff off of them before. Rifles or shotguns may not put very much gunshot residue on you because, again, the exit is way down at the end of the barrel. And so then from explosives, these are some of the compounds that come out of explosive detection. And I just wanted to show you how easy it is to separate and detect all the different components in these propellants. So you have nitroglycerin, trinitrotoluene, dinitrotoluene. So you can actually see if there's one or two nitros on there. Dimethyl phthalate, beta naphthol, diethyl phthalate. So all these different things. Here's ethyl centrolite and diphenylamine. So you have, you know, all of these different components. This right here might even be a fingerprint for a particular formulation of an explosive or a propellant.
That's what I was asking.
Yeah, so different amounts of all of these different compounds, you could classify them and say, oh, this is from this particular munitions plant or that munitions plant. So there's different places that produce explosives for mining, for military application, and then places that produce gunpowder. You can get Winchester or Federal or different
kinds. Is that information, like, accessible?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah,
so you can find out, you know, where the manufacturers get their different things.
Just like CODIS, right?
Yeah.
Like
yeah, but I mean, even it's somewhat publicly accessible. I mean, these companies do business, but they do business to business, but you can still find them. Now with the internet, you can find from a business to business type site where a company sells and they're a supplier for the military or a supplier for mining, you can find those companies. These are some of the compounds mentioned on the previous slide. So phthalic acid is a diacid. It's a benzene ring with two carboxylic acid groups on it.
Took
your ring. Okay. Yeah. That's good. And so those two groups, then you can form esters with them and put floppy molecules on there. So this is a really good plasticizer. Why do we want plasticizers? Think about your dashboard of your car. That new car smell is plasticizer, right? That plastic's brand new, and you're in there, and you're smelling all of these phthalates and everything, bisphenol, alcohol, and so on, BPAs. Those are probably not the best things for you. Again, it's that new car smell. And so over time, those plasticizers leave, and your dashboard gets brittle. So the polymers start to crystallize, and when they crystallize, you have hard domains and soft domains, and then cracks form, joining the hard domains to each other.
It's lubricant, kind of.
Yeah, so it keeps the fibers and the polymer plastic from moving. Plastic to glass is the transition you're trying to avoid. A glass is rigid. It doesn't have to be crystalline. There may be crystalline domains, but overall it's amorphous, like a glass. Yeah. So glasses are brittle, plastics are flexible. So those are sort of a physical properties terminology. And so the plasticizers keep a polymer from turning to a glass, becoming rigid, and then cracking. And so that's what you want for your dashboard. That's also what you want for your explosives. Because your explosives are bound together with plastics, polymers, polymer-bound explosives. And some of your propellants also have a little bit of polymer in them to hold them together. These aren't just powders dumped in. They're actually little pellets that are extruded wet, and they dry, and then those little pellets burn. And so you can change the rate of burn by changing the size of the pellet, because the surface area is where it burns. So if you have really tiny pellets, it'll burn fast. Bigger pellets will burn slower. You can actually tune the burn rate. And they're going to have these plasticizers in there to keep them from becoming brittle. So if your plastic becomes brittle and it turns kind of to a glass, and then that powder gets bumped or assaulted in some way, then those little grains break apart. And if you wanted a big grain, slow-burning propellant, and now all the particles are broken in half, you've doubled your surface area, and now it's going to burn faster. And that's not what you want. So for product quality, you want to control the physical properties of your propellant. And one way to do that is through plasticizers. So there's a lot of this stuff in there, potentially. And so you have these floppy molecules on phthalates. This diphenylamine is actually a fairly reactive molecule with oxygen and with nitro groups. And so if the explosive or propellant starts to decompose, this right here is an antioxidant, and so it will react with oxygen. Ethyl centrolite will do the same thing, and methyl centrolite will do the same thing. So these three are stabilizers, they're free radical scavengers, and so that's their role. Now the casings and so on, you can test those. We had a couple of questions on the chemical evidence of that, trace metals in casing, trace metals in jacketing material, looking, like we said, the evidence of this. The cell phone, if that cell phone was used to detonate a bomb, then we would have the evidence left behind, because the cell phone's not going to be atomized unless it's an atomic bomb. There's not going to be enough energy to take it completely apart. It's going to be crushed or dispersed in some way, but you can find the pieces and maybe get fingerprints off of it. For bombs, how is it? AF and F, arming, fusing, and firing. So arming is making it from a state where it can't detonate to a state where it can. So when you arm the device, it's now possible for it to detonate. Okay. The fusing part is how you actually get it started, right? Is it chemically fused? Is it mechanically fused? Is there something, a plunger or whatever? Or is it friction? You know, there's a lot of different ways to fuse a system. And then the firing, what is the energy associated with it? Is it heat? Is it electricity? So arming, fusing, and firing, there's many, many different ways to do that, and it's really a lot of physical evidence. How was it triggered? What was the control systems? Were there fail safes? Was there anti-tamper device? If you see anti-tamper, you know the sophistication is higher. What did they say about the Austin bomber? They were saying it's a sophisticated device. Why?
Because it
had anti-tamper.
No,
I don't think it had anti-tamper. There was another thing that they noticed that really made them worry, because they're like, uh-oh, this person's smart. It was a tripwire.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, so when they saw the tripwire, they thought, oh, this is another level of sophistication. Okay, not much more sophisticated.
No, that's what you
but it's not just like a kitchen timer, right? That's pretty low, right? You turn the kitchen timer around, you have two contacts, boom. Can't get any easier than that. But people are walking along and you're why is this mailbox ticking? You know, but that's also pretty easy to defeat, right? You go in there and you see the contacts, you know they're not contacted. When they do contact, they're going to blow something up. And so you hold the timer, keep it from turning, you peel the contact off, and now you've stopped it. You know, so again, that's pretty easy to disarm. Pretty low tech. If someone's using a kitchen timer to detonate something, it's pretty low tech. But if they've got a tripwire or some kind of anti-tamper stuff, then you've got a real problem. Okay. And then the size of the main charge. After the fact, you could do crater analysis. Now, these are some fantastic videos.
So is like placing the tripwire the arming part of it?
Yeah, it's part of the arming. Yeah, so you, well, I would say that's actually part of you would arm it, like you would set the tripwire and everything and then arm it. Because you wouldn't want to be fiddling with the tripwire while it's armed.
Oh, yeah.
So it's the tripwire is not the arming, it would be part of the firing.
Okay.
What's the mechanism that caused it to fire? Okay. So you at the firing site where I worked, they had shorting wires on the detonators. So these were all electrically fired. So an electric pulse would go and blow up the bridge wire and set off the detonator. And so they had wires that shorted those out. So if by accident the fire set sent a lot of electricity down to the detonator, it would go through this highway rather than through the tiny little bridge wire. So this short was enormous, not enormous, but a larger gauge wire that shorted out the leads. So the electricity would go down, it would go through the shorting path rather than through the bridge wire, which had a little bit more resistance. And so the last step would be get everything set up. They go down there with some wire clippers and clip that shorting wire and take it out. And now if the electrical pulse goes down, it goes through the bridge wire exclusively and detonates the detonator. So then I guess you would say it's armed, right? You've got it ready to go, it's armed, you clip the things, and then you walk away, it's ready to go. So after the blast, again, physical evidence, you could do crater analysis. And so these videos are from the New Mexico Tech School. So if you want to go to graduate school, if it bombs is your thing now after this course, you can go to graduate school at New Mexico Tech where they have a firing site and they train Department of Defense and different kinds of agencies, FBI, ATF, on how to analyze the craters and so on, how to detect and defeat bombs. And so that's the whole school related to bomb forensics. And these videos will tell you a lot more. And like this is a video of what is graduate school like, and it's a student there, and it says, if you suck at math, you will suck at graduate school. So that's either opinion.